Okay, everybody back in? Ready to go? We're going to talk about primates now. I just wanted to bring to your attention that Olympus, who helped sanction the meeting, has an example of their most recent microscope and the technology involved in the monitor. And on your break, you're welcome to come up and use it and look at it. And it's very, very, very nice microscope, and it's here just for you to review. All of my microscopes are Olympus. Maybe I shouldn't have said that because it may sound, you know. Then again, you know, I could be a spokesman for Olympus. Anyway, now we're going to talk about primate diseases. We're going to do both infectious and non-infectious diseases. The primates that I work with a lot of primates, but they are from zoological collections. They are not primates that are used experimentally. So the diseases that we see are primarily spontaneous disease, not diseases that have been induced during drug studies, etc. This is a spontaneous disease in primates. We'll start with cardiovascular disease. Cardiovascular diseases are very common in primates, especially older primates. The degenerative cardiomyopathies, atherosclerosis, aneurysms in certain species are a major problem. And then, of course, infectious diseases that involve the heart. But we'll discuss those as we get to the portion of the talk on infectious disease. Cardiomyopathy, as we use it in this case, will be primarily degenerative cardiomyopathies rather than congenital cardiomyopathies that might be associated with some form of developmental anomaly involving the heart and great vessels. There are many reasons why we see degenerative cardiomyopathy in primates. I listed these in your notes, frankly, age-related degenerative processes and concurrent disease processes, particularly stress or renal disease, will contribute to the development of the cardiogenic diseases that we see in these animals. Typically, with the degenerative cardiomyopathies, we'll see varying patterns from a gross perspective, including dilated cardiomyopathies, hypertrophic cardiomyopathies, cardiomyopathies that have no actual thickening or thinning of the walls, but a great deal of fibrosis within the walls. Depending on which side of the heart is affected the most severely, we will see chronic passive congestion, either in the lungs associated with left-sided cardiac insufficiency, or in the liver and abdominal cavity associated with right-sided cardiac insufficiency. And oftentimes we see both concurrently when the degenerative cardiac disease has become advanced. This is an owl monkey with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy involving the left ventricular free wall and septum with subsequent luminal attenuation and a globoid heart. This is a tamarin with a left ventricular dilated cardiomyopathy. Note the dilated lumen and the thin septum and left ventricular free wall, almost the same thickness as the right ventricle. Those animals with left-sided cardiac insufficiency will often present with a chronic intrathoracic effusion and consolidation of the lung due to a combination of atelectasis and chronic passive congestion within the lung. In addition to the thoracic effusion, depending on the severity of the cardiac lesion, there will also be an effusion within the pericardial sac. Those with right-sided cardiac insufficiency will have chronic passive congestion in the liver, and grossly the liver will have a reticular pattern model pattern, if you will, that is characteristic of the centrilobular disease process that is occurring in the parenchyma. Those animals with right-sided cardiac insufficiency oftentimes will also develop peripheral edema, especially in the back legs. The histologic appearance of the degenerative cardiac disease in primates is highly variable. One of the findings that we see fairly consistently in the apes and occasionally in the whole world monkeys is anisokaryosis in the myocardiocytes, sometimes quite profound anisokaryosis or nuclear enlargement in the myocardiocytes. There will be varying degrees of hypertrophy, atrophy, or disarray in the myofibers. Sometimes there will be some lipomatosis or steatosis, if you will, the accumulation of normal adipocytes within the myocardium, and valvular endocardiosis, or myxomatous change in the valve leaflets of the left and right atrial ventricular valves. And sometimes, especially with the hypertrophic variant of cardiomyopathy, there will be no histologic change that can be appreciated because the lesion is primarily hypertrophic, involves thickening of the wall, but not necessarily degenerative changes in individual myofibers. Interestingly enough, many of these animals have concurrent advanced renal disease and hypertensive changes in vessel walls. This is the histological appearance of these cardiac lesions in an older ape with degenerative cardiomyopathy. Extensive fibrosis extending through the fossil planes between bundles of myofibers in the ventricular free wall. Note that the fibrosis is especially severe around a larger blood vessel, and this seems to be the pattern. The early pattern of fibrosis starts around the blood vessels and then eventually works its way through the fossal planes into the surrounding myocardium and disrupts myofiber organization. This image has the fibrosis as previously discussed. Note that some of the myofibers are quite large and then some are quite small. And also note the anisokaryosis, the rather large nuclei that develop in these cases of advanced degenerative cardiomyopathy. This is a Sans trichome stain that is accentuating the fibrous tissue that is present within the myocardium. Atherosclerosis is the deposition of atherosclerotic plaques within the intima media of the vessel walls, and is somewhat common in primates. It usually is associated with a combination of high-fat diets, reduced or no exercise, and age-related degenerative processes. Frequently, these animals are also obese. There's an interesting form of glomerular atherosclerosis that occurs in the howler monkeys, both the red and golden howler monkeys and black howler monkeys. And this interesting disease is most likely due to oversupplementation of high-fat diets in that species. It is noteworthy that the glomerular atherosclerosis that we saw in the howler monkeys for several years is now only seen rarely because clinicians have implemented dietary changes that have greatly reduced the incidence of this disease. This is a glomerulus from a howler monkey with atherosclerosis, and all of this material in here represents macrophages that have a large amount of lipid in them. The change is also associated with some hypertrophy of mesangial cells and, in advanced cases, some syneteae of the tuft to the outer capsule of the glomerulus. This is a oil red O stain from a frozen section of liver showing the lipid content in the mesangium and capillaries of the affected glomerulus. And as with any glomerular disease, these glomeruli leak protein into the tubules. And when that happens, the tubules become necrotic. And when that happens, then there's a reaction in the surrounding interstitium, subsequently fibrosis and chronic inflammation. And these animals develop a combination of renal lesions that essentially manifests as nephrosclerosis and chronic renal disease, renal insufficiency, and subsequent hypertension. Arteriosclerosis is different than atherosclerosis. Arteriosclerosis implies sclerotic changes in the intima and media of the vessel wall, and generally is an age-related change, or a change that occurs in conjunction with hypertension. It may or may not be associated with atherosclerosis, but has a different pathogenesis. Any kind of rheologic abnormalities, such as endocarditis, will predispose to the development of arterial sclerosis, especially at the cardiac outflow tract. And with advanced cases, there's considerable attenuation of the lumen of the vessel, and likely there are problems with expansion and contraction of the vessel, and this results in vascular insufficiency. A location in the primates that is particularly affected by arterial sclerosis is the basilar artery at the base of the cerebellum. This is where all the blood flow comes into the brain, and the location in which many problems occur, infectious and degenerative. And in this particular case, severe arterial sclerotic changes resulted in thrombosis and subsequent thromboembolism to other portions of the brain. So a higher magnification showing a marked intimal thickening of the of the affected vessel. There's also some sclerotic change that is beginning to occur in the medial tunic. And of course, once that basilar artery becomes compromised, then blood flow to the rest of the brain becomes compromised, and some of these animals develop acute vascular accidents in the brain, so-called stroke, or development of acute hematoma formation in the brain. And of course, this is more than likely going to be acutely fatal. So you always want to take the brain out. Oh, we miss this lesion. In this, this is an orangutan. These older animals, some of these chimpanzees and gorillas that we get are over 50 years of age, and we see fairly advanced degenerative changes in the heart valves. This animal had particularly severe valvular endocarditis, and with subsequent endocarditis, we had some problems with blood flow, rheologic problems, and the development of sclerotic and ulcerative changes that occur in the intima of the great vessels of the cardiac outflow tract. This term is also sometimes referred to as a jet lesion because the flow of blood has been altered by the valvular lesion and is being directed in an abnormal way towards the intima of the great vessel. The valvular endocarditis is characterized by a fibromyxomatous change in the interstitium of the valve leaflet, and this accounts for the thickening of the valve leaflet, and should not be, and the gross lesion here should not be confused with vegetative endocarditis, vegetative valvular endocarditis, which is actually a bacterial infection involving the valve, and a much rougher, shaggy appearance to the valve than valvular endocarditis, which is typically a very smooth nodular lesion. Dissecting aortic aneurysms are a common cause of acute death in an otherwise clinically normal animal. And in the zoo world, the great apes and the calotrichids are especially susceptible to great apes, including the gorilla, bonobo, and the chimpanzee. We have not seen these lesions in the orangutans as of yet. In the calotrichids, these are the marmosets and tamarins. The idiopathogenesis of these dissecting aortic aneurysms is not well understood, at least not in the veterinary world. We can only correlate what we know about these aneurysms in humans to what we see in the veterinary world. In the human population, this is also a problem, has been associated with hypertension, atherosclerosis, Marfan syndrome, which is a collagen disorder, copper deficiency in turkeys has been associated with the development of these aneurysms. But generally speaking, we really don't know why they get it. Male gorillas are especially predisposed to developing these aortic aneurysms at approximately 30 to 40 years of age. Grossly, there will be severe enlargement of the aorta, generally extending several centimeters from the outflow tract. And when it ruptures, there's massive hemorrhage within the cardiac outflow tract and within the mediastinum and within the pericardial sac, the latter associated with cardiac tamponade, which is probably the cause of death. In the early stages of the aortic lesion, there's some mucinous degeneration of the intima and media of the vessel wall. And in later stages, there's hemorrhage that extends along these mucinous planes, eventually causing necrosis of the vessel wall and rupture of the vessel wall. And after that happens, just within minutes, the animal's dead. This is the pericardial sac that has been reflected to show the large amount of blood that's present within the pericardial sac associated with rupture of the aneurysm. This is the aneurysm itself at the base of the heart, just a big hematoma at this stage, and difficult to determine from where the blood flow originated. But you can see where the vessel wall is ruptured here. A higher magnification of one of these ruptured aortic aneurysms in a gorilla showing the area of necrosis that occurs as a result of these aneurysms and the site of the rupture after it's been cleaned up and all the blood's been removed. Histologically, this is the intima of the vessel up here in the corner. So we're looking at the media of the vessel wall and the adventitial surface of the vessel and the leading edge of the aneurysm occurring here. And here's the hemorrhage. You can see even a low magnification that these clearer spaces here represent mucinous degeneration, and this is being followed by hemorrhage. A higher magnification here showing much necrosis and inflammation at the site of chronicity involving the aneurysm. There's both acute hemorrhage, and doesn't show too well here, but also chronic hemorrhage or hemosiderosis in the area of necrosis. Here is a this is a transverse section through the vessel wall. This is the lumen, original lumen of the vessel. This is the aneurysm as it dissects its way through the media. Interestingly enough, in the basal vessorum, or the small vessels that supply blood to the vessel wall of the aorta, there are changes associated with hypertension. And hypertension is most likely one of the leading causes of these aortic aneurysms in these animals, most of which also have advanced renal disease. which leads us into our next segment on degenerative diseases in primates. The principal degenerative diseases that we see are chronic renal disease, cirrhosis, and arthritis. Age-related degenerative changes in the kidneys are very common cause of clinical disease and a very common reason for euthanasia of older primates in the zoological facilities. Probably in captivity in wild populations, chronic renal disease doesn't get this degree of severity that we see in captive populations, because the captive populations and the animals are being cared for, live much longer, would otherwise be culled in the wild, probably by other animals in truth, once they start to develop clinical renal disease. And when we see chronic renal disease in animals that are younger than expected for the species, it is likely that they have incurred already some form of past renal insult, either hypoxic change or an infectious problem that permanently altered the renal parenchyma, or had predisposed it to development of chronic degenerative changes prior than would be expected for that species age. Grossly, with chronic renal disease, there is usually an overall shrinkage of the renal parenchyma, not necessarily symmetrical shrinkage, but usually both kidneys will have some degree of shrinkage or pitting on the capsular surface, and then on cut surface, there will be streaks extending through the cortex and medulla. The cortex and medulla may not be as distinct as they would be in a normal kidney. In fact, there may be no demarcation at all between the cortex and medulla in an older animal with chronic renal disease. Frequently, on cut surface, there'll be small cysts of varying size, sometimes even fairly large cysts, that represent compression of the tubules and accumulation of protein or mineralized debris within the tube. Some species may even have amyloid deposits in the glomeruli or the interstitial. Typical presentation of chronic renal disease: asymmetrical shrinkage of the kidneys, some pitting of the surfaces, cyst-like structures within the parenchyma, demarcation between cortex and medulla has been somewhat altered here and is less distinct. And then there are also some areas of white discoloration or streaking that extend through the cortex and medulla. These are all old. These structures here are old infarcts, from previous vascular insults to the kidney. And histologically, there are areas of fibrosis, tubular cysts, areas of mild inflammation where tubules have ruptured, inciting an inflammatory response or fibrosis in the interstitium, and an overall depletion in the density of functional renal tubules. This is an end-stage kidney. No longer going to be able to compensate. Cirrhosis is usually seen in older animals and likely represents a combination of age-related degenerative processes. However, biliary obstruction, as might occur with cold in the thyroid or a chronic ascending inflammatory process of the biliary tree, long-term hepatic lipidosis, which has never been a good thing, especially in primates, or previous exposure to hepatotoxins, such as mycotoxins or pyrrolizidine alkaloids, will contribute to the development of cirrhosis. And the problem with the toxins is that the insult can be considerably earlier than the time at which the cirrhosis is diagnosed. So it's difficult to, in retrospect, determine if there was a toxin exposure. Cirrhotic liver with marked nostril appearance to the hepatic parenchyma and Sometimes there will also be a concurrent neoplastic process occurring within the liver in some of these cases. Histologically, cirrhosis is characterized by zones of bridging fibrosis in the portal tracts, nodular regeneration of hepatocytes, and even in some areas of hepatocellular lipidosis. Degenerative arthritis is very common in the older primates, especially the larger primates, like the apes, and involving the articulations of the long bones, the digits, and especially the acetabulum and femoral head, or the vertebral articulations, so-called ankylosing spondylosis. And the latter, when severe, will sometimes also be associated with impingement on the root ganglia or compression of the spinal cord. And these animals subsequently are not able to ambulate well. Grossly, there might be ankylosis or hexoptosis or emergation of the cartilage, in other words, an ulcer on the surface of the articular cartilage that has become worn and actually kind of shiny from persistent abrasion with the opposing articular surface. When the discs are involved, the discs will become mineralized, flattened, or will proptose up into the spinal canal or down into the fossil planes that are surrounding the spinal column and contribute to the development of ankylosing spondylosis. Histologically, the changes that occur with arthritis include the development of fibrocartilaginous or osteocartilaginous exostoses around the lips of the joint. These might break off and go into the lumen of the joint space, so-called joint mice or osteophytes. The joint capsules can become fibrotic, and there might be chronic inflammation within the joint capsule. Articular surface of a long bone with marked ulceration of the articular cartilage, and the opposing surface also ulcerated with considerable eburnation of the articular surface. Thickening of the joint capsule, fibrocartilaginous exostoses along the lip of the joint, and along the vertebral column, both discs are flattened. This one is absent because it has partially proptosed into the spinal canal. Another one has proptosed downward, contributing to the development of ankylosing spondylosis. Because degenerative arthritis is so common in the primates at zoological facilities, the veterinarians have worked with many different kinds of drugs to try to improve the quality of life with these animals, alleviate some of the pain, and increase their mobility, their appetite, their outward disposition, make them less vulnerable to attacks from conspecifics that perceive them as sick. And there have been varying degrees of success using various drugs. Most of the drug use has been non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and these drugs in and of themselves have problems. And subsequently, we have seen a number of problems associated with them histologically and grossly. The most common being ulcerative gastritis associated with the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. However, now, with the advent of some of the other drugs that are used to augment the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, the incidence of these drug-related lesions has gone down. The clinicians are using more tramadol and gabapentin in conjunction with these non-steroidal drugs, so that we are seeing much less gastritis, few perforating ulcers. Every once in a while we will get a focus of papillary necrosis in the kidney associated with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. I haven't seen that in a long time because I think that the use of the non-steroidals has been greatly tapered with these other drugs that seem to be beneficial. Talk about deposition disorders now, and it's one of my favorite subjects in all species, particularly important in reptiles, which we'll talk about this afternoon, but also important in the primates. We'll start with amyloid. Most of what we see in the primates is reactive systemic amyloidosis, AA amyloid, which is a serum amyloid protein that is especially prominent in the serum following acute inflammation, which is an acute phase protein. And accordingly, because it is an acute phase protein and associated with inflammation, it is often the case that the amyloidosis is associated with an inflammatory process in the affected patient, such as tuberculosis or a chronic mycotic infection or chronic inflammatory bowel disease. We see amyloidosis most commonly in the calotrichids and less commonly in the other species. Where we see it is primarily in the sinusoids of the liver and in the glomeruli of the kidneys, sometimes within the interstitium of the pancreas or around the pancreatic ducts, and then in the mucosa of the small intestine. Grossly, amyloidosis causes generalized organ enlargement and some degree of organ pallor as well. And for those tissues such as the spleen or liver, there will be some rounding of the margins of the tissue. Histologically, deposition of homogeneous amphiphilic material that is extracellular and stains positive with Congo red technique, and usually will be green with birefringent light or polarized light. On cut surface, the cortex of this kidney is somewhat granular, it bulges a little bit, and is sort of a pale tan, waxy material, or rather a waxy, it has a waxy feel to it when you palpate it on cut surface. And in the liver, sort of an off tan appearance and rounding of the margins, overall swelling of the lobe, and then in the intestine here, an accentuated corrugated appearance to the mucosa and swelling of the mucosal folds. This lesion could be mistaken for many other things, particularly mycobacteriosis in the gut. Histologically, in the liver, hepatic cords are markedly disrupted due to the deposition of the amyloid within the sinusoids. In the kidney, the glomeruli have thickening of the mesangium and the basement membranes associated with amyloid deposits. The subsequent leakage of protein into the tubules, which then becomes cystic or rupture. A Congo red stain will accentuate the presence of the amyloid, which stains pink with the Congo red, and then if polarized light is applied, the amyloid will have a green birefringent appearance. Islet amyloidosis is a different form of amyloid deposition, and this is common in primates, especially in the old world primates, and occasionally in the apes. The amyloid is produced by islet cells, but is toxic to beta cells. So in those cases in which the islet amyloid, which is called islet amyloid polypeptide, is sufficiently severe to eliminate all of the beta cells, then these animals are prone to developing diabetes mellitus. Generally, though, the lesion is not as severe as seen here. I mean, in this particular case, every islet in the field has marked depletion in the density of islet cells due to the deposition of the islet amyloid. And subsequently, this animal may be prone to developing islet amyloidosis. I might add that islet amyloidosis is also a disease that is commonly encountered in the domestic cat. And when severe, can eventually result in diabetes mellitus. This is just a congo red stain accentuating the presence of the amyloid within the islet. And note the marked depletion of islet cells. Generally, an islet is just completely packed with islet cells. There are no gross lesions associated with islet amyloidosis in primates. Because this is a microscopic change. So in that regard, it is always important to collect a section of pancreas for histologic examination, because what might look like normal pancreas in necropsy may actually be severely diseased in the root of the problem. There are two different types of mineralization that occur. Dystrophic mineralization is generally a localized event and associated with tissue damage at that site, be it a focus of trauma or age-related degenerative change, a bite wound, some form of localized tissue damage. Metastatic mineralization, or metastatic calcification as it's sometimes called, is a systemic disease, and it is associated with derangements in calcium metabolism, as might occur with derangements in dietary calcium or underlying problems with renal disease in which calcium metabolism has been altered, or associated with a paraneoplastic process in which there's a secretion of hormones that draw calcium from the bones. Oversupplementation of the diet with vitamin D will also cause metastatic mineralization. But we'll start with dystrophic mineralization. We see this as a result of vitamin E deficiency, or supplementation of fat, chronic irritation or cellulitis, and a term sometimes used for localized dystrophic mineralization is calcinosis circumscriptor. That's a very characteristic histologic appearance, and thus the term. Calcinosis circumscriptor is also synonymous with pseudogout, or tumoral calcinosis. And in this particular case, we have a focus of calcinosis circumscriptor in the finger of a chimpanzee that was previously bitten by another chimpanzee. I already talked about that, but let's have a look. In those cases of metastatic mineralization, vessel walls, mucosa, and basement membranes of various tissues, primarily kidney, lung, and gut, will become mineralized. In this particular case, this is stomach, and the whole entire mucosa has become mineralized due to hypercalcemia, metastatic hypercalcemia. And subsequent to the mineralization of the mucosa has become ulcerated, and when that happens, then they get secondary bacterial infection. Also, if the vessels are mineralized, they can rupture with any kind of trauma, and it can be very, very mild trauma that can result in the ruptured vessel and subsequent hemorrhage. This is a section of lung that has extensive mineralization of the interstitial and basement membranes of the vessel walls, And it's hard to see it in the gross, but there are areas of interstitial mineralization that are predisposed to developing hemorrhage in the perineum following an episode of trauma. Pneumoconiosis implies deposition of inorganic dust like silica, iron, plant material, and this is primarily seen in the lung and occurs as these accumulations of black pigment material within and on the surface of the pulmonary parenchyma. And it usually implies exposure to a dusty or smoky or polluted environment. Typically, pneumoconiosis is an incidental finding. Doesn't really cause much disease, but can be misconstrued as metastatic melanoma, or also at times resembles the lesions of pulmonary acrophysis, mite infections in the lung, which occur somewhat frequently in some of the old world monkeys. In extreme cases, and I haven't seen very many extreme cases, the most severe cases I see are those from densely populated cities and polluted air. And even in those extreme cases, I think it's mostly incidental. But you can see a bit of a reaction, histiocytic reaction, and sometimes some myelofibrosis around these foci of pneumoconiosis in the lung. Pneumoconiosis in the lung of birds, though, can be a much more severe problem than it is in the mammals. The hepatocellular lipidosis in mammals in general is not well tolerated. There are some species that can tolerate hepatocellular lipidosis better than others, and we'll talk about that in some of the reptile species. But in mammals, generally, it is not well tolerated when it is severe. And it can be associated with high fat diets, reduced level of exercise, metabolic arrangements, any endocrine or metabolic arrangement, exposure to toxins. And the important thing is, in its early stages, hepatolipidosis is reversible. Occasionally, when it's really severe, lipidosis will also be seen in other tissues, aside from the liver, such as the kidney especially, and in the adrenal or in the gut, enterocytes of the gut. At that, the causes are oftentimes not well understood, but those known causes include overnutrition, inanition, endocrine metabolic arrangements, and active reproductive status of the female. Sometimes those animals that have hepatic lipidosis or renal lipidosis will have very striking hypertriglyceridemia in the serum, which can be a problem for interpreting blood work. Grossly, those affected tissues, particularly liver, are enlarged, tan, and friable. By friable, I mean that with manipulation, the parenchyma is easily fractured. And subsequently, these animals are prone to developing internal exsanguination following a traumatic event. For instance, a fall from a perch or a tree. Primates in the zoos are always swinging from one tree to another or on a rope. Or lung trauma from aggressive behavior of a conspecific. Histologically, the diagnosis of hepatocellular lipidosis is not difficult. The cells are swollen and contain lipid droplets, or spherical droplets that displace the nucleus of the cell. Cut surface of liver with severe hepatic lipidosis, renal hepatic lipidosis, marked pallor in the cortex associated with the accumulation of lipid within the renal tubular epithelial cells. This is the accumulation of lipid within the hepatocytes that corresponds with the hepatic region. These animals oftentimes are obese, and there will also be concurrent steatosis. That's an accumulation of adipocytes and tissues where it normally would not occur. In this case, in the interstitial between the thyroid follicles. The accumulation of iron in various tissues can be referred to as hemosiderosis or iron storage. The pathologic accumulation of iron in tissues has been referred to as hemochromatosis. Hemochromatosis is a genetic disease that occurs in humans. So the use of the term hemochromatosis in animals other than humans is probably not appropriate. And another suggested term might be iron storage disease. We see iron storage in animals for various reasons, including high iron in the diet, an increased sensitivity to absorption of dietary iron, as would occur with, you know, feeding a high level of iron to an animal that is native to an environment in which iron is very low concentration. So they have a high sensitivity to absorption of iron to compensate for that. So that when we feed them a diet that has a high level of iron in it, they get iron overload in the tissue. Also, there are some cofactors that accelerate the absorption of dietary iron, such as vitamin C. So if animals are being oversupplemented with vitamin C to compensate for the perception of scurvy or the prevention of scurvy, then they could possibly be predisposed to the development of iron storage disease. Iron storage is especially common in the calotrichids, the lemurs, and the gorillas, and primarily it's seen in the liver, but you can also see iron storage in guts, lean, kidney, heart, pancreas, various other tissues. It's important to distinguish the difference, though, between hemosiderosis and iron storage disease, because hemosiderosis can occur as a result of dietary absorption or iron sequestration associated with chronic disease processes and may be completely incidental to whatever other disease process is present. Those animals with iron storage disease generally will have a swollen, bronze-colored liver. Sometimes there'll be some scarring that would indicate that there's a cirrhosis occurring as well. A large amount of yellow gold pigment will be present in the cytoplasm or hepatocytes. Sometimes there'll be some toxic change in the hepatocytes as well, primarily an esokaryosis or a cytomegalic change in the hepatocytes. In severe cases, there'll be disruption of the hepatic cords. They no longer have the nice plate formation that is typical for hepatic parenchyma. And there'll be some necrosis. This eventually results in scarring, biliary hyperplasia, fibrosis, and subsequently have a cirrhotic liver. In some cases, particularly in calotrichids and lemurs, transformation to biliary adenocarcinoma or hepatocellular carcinoma occurs. This is a case of advanced iron storage disease. A large amount of granular brown pigment present within hepatocytes and Kupffer cells and associated with biliary hyperplasia in this case. And there's a zone of fibrosis here as well. With a Prussian blue iron stain, large amount of iron present in the hepatocytes of Hooper cells. This needs to be distinguished from other dark brown pigments, particularly copper, and that's why the stain is done. Melanin deposition is occasionally seen in the primates. It is important to distinguish this from metastatic focus of melanoma, but generally melanin pigment disorders are uncommon in mammals. Sometimes we'll see melanin deposition in meninges, as you see here. But this is an incidental finding, not associated with disease. There is something called Dubin-Johnson-like syndrome that occurs in golden line tamarins, in which melanin accumulates in the central of the regions of the liver. And this has been associated with a low degree or a low level of hyperbilirubinemia, but otherwise these animals are clinically normal, and this resembles the Dubin-Johnson syndrome that is seen in humans. Nephrolysts and colonlysts and urolysts are pretty common in the old primates. We see them quite frequently in all species, and generally they're incidental unless they become obstructive, particularly in the liver, in the bile duct, or in a common bile duct. They can be problematic for clinicians because depending on where the lip is, it can be associated with some enzyme alterations. For instance, if there's some nephrolithiasis occurring, you know, there'd be some elevations in renal parameters or problems with urinalysis. If it's in the liver, you know, there'd be some elevated liver enzymes and bile acids. And subsequently, you know, it might be necessary to get to remove these lids or try to treat them clinically. This is a chimpanzee with a fairly large, a urolith at this stage. It's a very large one in the pelvis that has resulted in some hypernephrosis, a little bit higher magnification than the lids laying in the pelvis of the kidney. Note the marked tortuosity in the common bile duct leading up to the liver here. It's also got a fatty liver. And when you open up the gallbladder, you know, it's just completely full of colitis. Histologically, what I wanted to illustrate related to the nephrolithiasis is a change that occurs in the transitional epithelial cells. This is a low magnification of this kidney, and it obviously has some tubular distension and some protein gas in the tubules. The tubular epithelial cells, as they merge with the confluence of the renal pelvis, are lined by markedly hypertrophy transitional epithelial cells. And this is probably a reactive change associated with the urolithiasis. And it should not be confused with transitional cell carcinoma developing in the epithelial cells. Nutritional diseases are very common in the primates and the zoological facilities, as they are with the rest of the different species that we work with. Emaciation, obesity, metabolic or nutritional bone disease, scurvy, vitamin E deficiency sometimes, and even zinc deficiency can be problematic in the captive populations of primates that we work with. Obesity is especially common because we just love these animals to death, so to speak, and feeding them a smorgasbord of excellent foods, and that in conjunction with confinement or reduction in their level of exercise, results in obesity. And with obesity, we see hepatic and renal lipidosis, atherosclerosis. But we also see emaciation. And this is common in individual animals that are in mixed or crowded exhibits, or there's a problem with exhibit design. Occasionally the diet is suboptimal, not so much anymore. Or there may be concurrent disease. Maternal neglect in the neonates is a very much a common problem. Maternal illness during gestation may result in neonates that are born emaciated. And what we see in these animals, grossly and histologically, is atrophy of fat and atrophy of some of the organs, especially the pancreas and the liver. Just an example here of serous atrophy of fat in the cardiac group of an emaciated animal, and this corresponds to the serous atrophy at the histologic level as well. A lesion that is a very common diagnosis and can be the only lesion present in a histologic examination of a complete set of necropsy tissues in an animal. The primary lesion being in the adipose tissue, which is completely atrophic, sometimes all the way to the level of the bone marrow. And when we get lesions like this, we know that these animals were emaciated regardless of what the clinical interpretation of the case was. Scurvy can occur in all of the primates because they are deficient in an enzyme that is needed to form vitamin C. I can never pronounce this, the lactone oxidase. And vitamin C is needed for the synthesis of collagen. So when vitamin C is deficient, collagen production is suboptimal, and those structures that are dependent on collagen synthesis become compromised, and these animals develop various connective tissue lesions and hemorrhage in various tissues. Some of the typical lesions of scurvy are hemorrhage and icterus involving the mucous membranes of the mouth. Sometimes big hematomas will form in the connective tissues, especially over the skull, where there are areas where a part of the body that frequently undergoes a mild degree of trauma in exhibits. Also, the development of hemorrhage in the joints, corresponding to the hemorrhage in the joints corresponds to growth plate malformations associated with the impaired formation of the growth plate becomes malformed due to inability to mineralize spicules, and subsequently there being pathologic fractures in the growth plate and hemorrhage in the surrounding connective tissues. Metabolic bone disease is seen in both old and young animals, and the older animals is usually associated with chronic renal disease, and in the younger animals is usually more of a nutritional problem. When it's associated with renal disease, it's referred to as renal secondary hyperparathyroidism, and when it's associated with nutritional disease, it's referred to as nutritional secondary hyperparathyroidism. These animals will have a normal or inverted calcium phosphorus ratio. Generally, it's the ionized calcium in the serum that is the most important factor related to calcium homeostasis. And when the ionized calcium is depleted, is when they begin to develop metabolic derangements associated with calcium death. bodies can't synthesize vitamin D3. So they have to be supplemented with vitamin D3. And in that regard, they may be more susceptible to development of nutritional secondary hyperparathyroidism. The lesion that is fibrous osteodystrophy involving the bones and surrounding connective tissues. Once the bone is depleted of calcium, the body's response to that is to try to stabilize the lesion with fibrous tissue, and subsequently there will be thickening of the connective tissues around the affected bones, so there'll be much thickening of the jaw region, facial flat bone regions, or along the diaphysis and the metaphyseal regions of the long bones. Because the bone density is compromised, there will be pathologic fractures or bowing of the long bones with these cases. This is an animal with advanced rickets, showing the malformations in the femur, the bowing of the tibia, and corresponding histologic appearance, some bowing of the long bones, thickening of the fibrous tissue around them, and also in some of these cases there will be an attempt to develop some bone along the diaphysis beneath the periosteum, so-called subperiosteal reactive bone formation, an attempt to stabilize that bone so that it does not develop a pathologic fracture. This is a metaphyseal region in which there have been several pathologic fractures occurring due to reduced bone density and subsequently a bowing effect or malformation occurring. Causing a disfigurement of the bone. Also, we'll sometimes see pathologic fractures occurring along the costochondral junctions of the ribs of these animals simply from the constant force of breathing or trauma. Swelling of the dental arcades due to fibrous metaplasia. And another image showing the fibrous metaplasia associated with metabolic bone disease and facial flat bones. In this tamarin, a young tamarin, a failure of fusion of the sulci of the flat bones of the skull, and almost transparent flat bones that can be easily compressed. Neoplasia is somewhat common in the zoo primates. We see a broad spectrum of neoplastic processes, and I'll discuss some of them that are important to the zoo world. Endocrine neoplasia, primarily islet cell tumors, and we see this in the calotrichids. Look, I'm going to walk right in front of that camera. I have a problem with pacing when I lecture and I'm getting in the way of that. But calotrichids, lemurs, and galagos are somewhat prone to developing islet cell tumors. These are aggressive malignancies in almost all species, with the exception of rats and ferrets, in which islet cell tumors tend to be much less aggressive tumors and oftentimes benign. In other species, including dogs and cats, islet cell tumors are aggressive malignancies that will metastasize and frequently are associated with peritoneoplastic syndromes. This is the pancreas of a calotrichid that has a couple of these islet cell tumors in it, and this is metastasized here to the regional lymph node. Pheochromocytomas are particularly common in the New World monkeys. A manuscript that has recently come out on this, and especially in calotrichids. They are generally benign, well-differentiated tumors, but they are sometimes functional and associated with hypertension. This is one of these fetal chromocytomas, and it is displacing and compressing the cortex of the adrenal gland, and it's also encapsulated, typical benign features of these tumors. Reproductive tumors and other masses are somewhat common. Ovarian cysts are common in the macaques arising from the follicle or reed apparatus or the mesonephrica. Granulosa cell tumors are especially common in squirrel monkeys, and they are generally bilateral, but non-functional. And occasionally we'll see a teratoma or a smooth muscle tumor, polyps in the vulva or vagina. Interestingly enough, testicular tumors are uncommon in primates. Other tumors. This is an image of a ovarian cyst in a primate. This is a teratoma. Teratomas are very interesting tumors that represent all three embryologic cell lines. Mesoderm producing mesenchymal cells, the ectoderm producing nerve cells and related cells, and the endoderm producing epithelium. So, when you have a tumor involving all three of these structures, the tumor can have all kinds of different tissues in it. It can even have hair in it, and ocular structures, bone, tissue that looks like brain. There might be vessels or epithelial-lined ducts, all constituting the neoplasm. It can be a very interesting histologic study. Most of them are benign. This is a smooth muscle tumor, showing what perhaps is one of its only problems, and that is that it will eventually outgrow its blood supply, and there'll be some necrosis or ulceration, and then we have a little bit of trouble with these smooth muscle tumors. But generally speaking, for most of them, it's an incidental finding. And this is a granulosa cell tumor in the ovary of a squirrel monkey. Again, these are very common in squirrel monkeys and often bilateral. That information has recently also become published in the literature. Cotton top tamarins are prone to developing inflammatory bowel disease. And the cause for the inflammatory bowel disease has not been determined. A lot of different proposed etiologies, none of which have been proven. Helicobacter, coronavirus, flagellates. But the most important thing about inflammatory bowel disease in the cotton-top tamarin is that these lesions sometimes, in fact, fairly frequently, will transform to intestinal adenocarcinomas. And these are malignant neoplasms that will metastasize to the mesenteric lymph nodes and abdominal viscera. This is a focus of transformation of adenocarcinoma and metastatic lesion in the lymph nodes. Perhaps the most common of the neoplastic processes that occur in macaques is the intestinal adenocarcinoma. And that can occur just about anywhere in the alimentary tract, including small intestine, colon, and cecum. And just like the cotton-top tamarin and most other species that develop intestinal adenocarcinomas, these tumors have potential for metastasis to the mesenteric lymph nodes. Mammary tumors are remarkably uncommon in primates other than humans. And when you consider the prevalence of mammary neoplasia in women, you would think that there would be a high rate of metastasis, a mammary gland neoplasia in other primates. But the fact of the matter is, mammary tumors are considered rare in all species of non-human primates, with possibly the exception of lemurs. We have a large number of lemurs in our archives of mammary gland adenocarcinomas, and these tumors are aggressive malignancies that readily metastasize. And this information also is now available in the literature. lemurs, they seem to be more prone to developing neoplastic processes than some of the other primates. And neoplastic processes involving the liver are common in lemurs. Hepatocellular carcinomas are common, and these tumors readily metastasize to the lung. This is a hepatocellular tumor that has metastasized to the lung. And because lemurs are prone to developing cirrhosis associated with iron storage, they also are prone to developing neoplastic processes in the liver associated with that process. So hepatocellular neoplasia in the lemur is common for various reasons. Well, we'll move on now to the infectious diseases. And we'll start with bacterial infections. These are perhaps the most important of the infectious diseases that we see at Northwest UPath. And most are not zoonotic, only a few. We'll start with mycobacteriosis. Mycobacteriosis, or tuberculosis, is perhaps the most important of the bacterial diseases affecting mammals. Fortunately, mycobacteriosis now is uncommon in primates because of our testing procedures. But there are some primates that seem to be particularly predisposed to developing mycobacteriosis regardless. And what we primarily see now are the atypical mycobacterial infections, M. avium and Kansasii, rather than the more classic and zoonotic mycobacteriums such as bovis and tuberculosis. Still, even though what we see now primarily the atypical mycobacteria or mycobacterium avium, there is some zoonotic potential for those organisms, particularly in humans that are immunosuppressed for whatever reason. Perhaps the most common presentation of mycobacteriosis that we see in zoo primates now is M. avium presentation in Psyche monkeys. And the reason that we don't see so much mycobacteriosis is because skin testing and culling has been used now at most of the zoological facilities. However, some of these cases of M. avium, M. paratuberculosis don't respond or do not test positive by the mycobacterium skin test. Grossly, mycobacteriosis is fairly typical in these species, multiple vertically sized, white, nodular masses that are present in the viscera, usually in the lung and lymph node, but also occasionally in the abdominal viscera. And histologically, caseal calcareous granulomas and organisms can sometimes be difficult to find, especially with the more zoonotic pathogens, M. bovis and M. tuberculosis. This is a skin test, a positive skin test, a reactor, if you will, that has been checked 48 hours after administering the tuberculin test agent. When this swelling occurs in the eyelid, that animal is interpreted as a positive reactor and will be culled from the group. This test is usually done during quarantine as animals are coming into the facility. They never even make it into the zoo population. This is a section of lung showing coalescing foci of granulomatous inflammation, a section of liver with numerous nodules within the parenchyma, and even a section of brain with a focus of granulomatous inflammation. Histologically, a low magnification image with this broad coracoagulum of cellular debris, what we refer to as caseous necrosis, and that's surrounded by a rim of inflammatory cells, predominantly histiocytes, and multinucleate giant cells. And if we're lucky, using an acid fast stain, we'll see a few of these organisms within the cytoplasm of the macrophages and giant cells, or sometimes just within the areas in case he has to breathe. Atypical mycobacteriosis generally involves the M. avium complex, and there are enteric and respiratory forms. There may be a trend for the enteric form in the macaques and New World monkeys. Siamangs and sacs. Marked thickening of the mucosa of the intestine in the case of enteric mycobacteriosis. Note the resemblance to the intestine that I showed you that had amyloidosis. Large numbers of histiocytes fill the lamina propria of the intestine, and this accounts for the thickening of the mucosa, the higher magnification showing the histiocytes, and an acid fast scan showing the presence of a few acid fast bacteria within the cytoplasm of the macrophages. Yersiniosis is caused by Yersinia pseudotuberculosis or Yersinia enterocolitica. We do not see pestis, Yersinia pestis, in the zoological facilities of the United States. Yersiniosis is associated with a cycle of birds, rodents, entering the exhibits. This is the likely route of exposure. The disease is also seen occasionally in ruminants, but the animals most often affected by Yersiniosis are birds, rodents, and primates. There is some zoonotic potential, but as with the atypical mycobacteria, the zoonotic potential is low and probably limited to those individuals that have some form of immunosuppression. Generally, Yersiniosis is a sporadic disease. Occurs, you know, in one individual within a group that has been exposed to it, perhaps by capturing an infected mouse that entered the exhibit. But there can occasionally be substantial outbreaks of the disease, depending on the vector, and the density of the organism in the environment. Especially so in some of the avian exhibits at the zoos. I have had some instances in which Yersiniosis is completely wiped out in the last year. The route for Yersinia is oral. The initial lesion is enteritis, and then it disseminates through the liver and spleen, lung, and bone marrow. Grossly, there will be fibrinohemorrhagic or supramembranous enteritis, sometimes referred to as raspberry mucosa, which is a bad term. Don't use it. And then into the liver and spleen, wall of the intestine, microabscesses will form. And these will have a high density of organisms, a large colony of organisms, sometimes surrounded by a very narrow zone of suppurative inflammation. Sometimes there is hardly any inflammation at all in these lesions. And then the bacteria are gram-negative organisms. Gross appearance, showing the reddening and pseudomembrane-like formation on the mucosa of the intestines corresponds to ulceration and development of an inflammatory pseudomembrane in the areas of erosion and ulceration. In the liver, many small foci, white discoloration, sometimes somewhat nodular, but generally not too nodular. And then histologically, very characteristic appearance. A large colony of bacteria surrounded by a very narrow zone of inflammation, if any inflammation at all, and sometimes some concurrent necrosis. It is pretty much a classic lesion. We occasionally see tularemia in some of the primate collections in the United States. Is tularemia endemic here in the Balkans? It is. What is the host?
The hair.
It's the hair.
Lepus europaeus.
Okay. Yeah, hair. Yeah, in the United States, rabbits and beavers are the most common host for this organism, but also can get into rats and mice. And this is the exposure for primates in outdoor exhibits. Occasionally, a mouse or a rat will wander into the exhibit, and the primates will grab it and eat it. And we will occasionally see these cases of tularemia. And of course, it's a very much a zoonotic disease. So always want to, when you do a necropsy, always consider the possibility of zoonotic disease, regardless of what your necropsy.
It's a classic zoonosis in Europe, especially Southern Europe, of the chef that prepares the hair for the cooking. I use the term
chefs are predisposed.
Well, I use the term chef because in the past there was another person preparing the cooking. I would be sexist to say. So I said the person that cooks the meal now gets it. It's a classic, Tuscan especially. And when you see a hair that you can catch with your hands when you're hunting, that's bad news. Don't let that hair alone.
Yes, right.
That's
right.
A classic.
Absolutely. Hunters that touch without gloves, touch the meat of the animal that they've killed. I didn't know about the chefs. I think that's very interesting.
Well, look at, when I grew up, it was the classic zoonotic disease of the wife of the hunter. So I didn't want to use the term wife of the hunter, so I said the chef. So, because, you know, now guys cook a lot, so that could be anybody.
Very interesting. So historically it was the wives,
yeah.
But now, because men do the cooking as well.
Yeah, exactly.
That's
so you see,
right. Well, interesting story about tuberculosis, and that beer cow is considered the father of modern pathology. Extensively studied mycobacteriosis because his father was a butcher, and he was, as a child, in charge of removing the offal, the organs and so forth, and taking them into the back of the facility and burying them. And when he did this, he had noticed that in a large proportion of the cases that some of these visceral tissues had nodules in them. And then as he got better educated, he returned to his study of these nodules from a scientific perspective. And of course, that led to our understanding of tuberculosis. And very interesting, the associations that lead to our investigations of disease. I love the history of how some of these developed. But anyway, tularemia, in these primates, causes similar lesions that it causes in other species. Pneumonia and hepatitis, lymphadenitis, it's essentially a septic process. And one of the differences between tularemia and yersiniosis is that organisms with tularemia are not as plentiful in the lesions. Sometimes you get lucky and you got a lot of organisms, you can see them either histologically or with a tissue gram stain, but more often than not, it can be quite challenging to see these organisms in the lesion, which in and of itself becomes a suspicion that might have tularemia, has severe lesions and you can't find an organism. But the gross lesions are very similar to yersiniosis. Many small white foci throughout the parenchyma of the liver, spleen, the gut has a similar appearance, red or eroded mucosa. And this is a histologic image of the liver showing these areas of acute necrosis and associated with extracellular and intracellular bacteria, but you don't always see them. That's much more challenging. The way that tularemia is diagnosed now, at least the way that I diagnose it, is first I look at the histologic images. If there's a suspicion of tularemia and I can't find the organism or they didn't culture it, then as Fabio had mentioned earlier today, we will take slivers off of the paraffin block and send them to a laboratory that has primers to check for DNA of Francisella tularensis.
I think since we are talking about this molecular characterization of agents, you know, at the beginning we have difficulties to do this because many people said, no, you need to start with PCR from fresh tissues.
Yes.
In reality, our paraffin collections are pure gold mines, and don't let people of diagnostic laboratory is misleading you, saying that you cannot do it from fixed tissue or paraffin block. Paraffin block are the ultimate, except for some adenovirus, the ultimate sample where you can get your nucleic acids out. And there are specific kits, two or three on the market, which don't cost much, that allow pretty much any laboratory to extract the nucleic acids. It's a little bit more difficult with some RNA viruses than being formalin first for quite a bit and then in paraffin, but generally we can do quite a bit.
Now our procedures for using PCR and paraffin embedded tissue are much better than they used to be. And subsequently, our archives of paraffin blocks have become a very important source for researchers. And I have my paraffin blocks from the day of inception in 1994. For over 200,000 animals, I have the paraffin blocks. And if we need to go back and look at any kind of DNA study, then those blocks are available to do that. And some of the blocks will be in better shape than others. A lot of it depends on how long the tissue was in formalin prior to being embedded in the paraffin block. And that is an important point to bring up. Once you do your necropsy and you put your tissues in formalin, then get those to the pathologist as soon as possible. Don't let them sit on the shelf for a month before sending them in, because the longer those tissues are in formalin, the less sensitive our diagnostic procedures will be, our ancillary diagnostic procedures will be, such as immunohistochemistry, in situ hybridization, or PCR and sequencing. So it's important to get them into formalin to fix them, but it's also important to get them out of formalin and into paraffin as soon as possible after they become fixed. Shigellosis is a disease that affects old world, new world, and apes, and also humans, I might add, and causes a similar disease to some of the other ones we've talked about, apohemorrhagic colitis and gastritis. It does not particularly target the small intestine. Interestingly enough, shigellosis also is associated with gingivitis, ulcerative gingivitis in primates. Carriers of the Shigella organism are common, and so the cause for the development of clinical disease is speculative, most likely associated with stressors or dysbiosis in the gut. Typical colonic lesion associated with shigellosis, marked reddening of the serosal surface corresponding to ulceration and pseudomembrane formation involving the mucosal surface, transmural inflammation, fiber deposition, thrombosis in the vessel walls, and eventually sepsis because of the involvement of the vessels. In case of severe gingivitis associated with the organism in a primate. Now there are a lot of differentials for pseudomembranous gut lesions that should be considered when you're doing primate work. There is no diagnostic gross lesion of the gut. You have to do additional diagnostic work. But some of the additional differentials, you know, you want to consider are salmonellosis, yersiniosis, amebiasis, colibacillosis, campylobacter infection, and brachyspiral infection. Leptospirosis used to be a lot more common than it is now in the zoological collections. I think probably because husbandry practices have improved considerably. But we still have road protectors that bring the disease in, and animals will develop a renal disease with hematuria. In the acute forms, we'll see hepatic necrosis and icterus abortions. In the chronic form, severe lymphocytic tubular interstitial nephritis. And that is the form that I see most frequently. And that in and of itself is also uncommon. This is a case of severe chronic interstitial tubular interstitial nephritis associated with leptospirosis. Marked depletion in tubular density due to tubular necrosis and disruption. Inflammation is present throughout the interstitial and obliterates renal tubules in those areas. This almost looks like lymphoma in these cases, it's so severe. But usually there'll be enough pleomorphism in that infiltrate. Now, there'll be predominantly small lymphocytes and occasional plasma cells and neutrophils, enough to lead you away from a diagnosis of lymphoma. And then do a Wharton starry stain, and the Wharton starry stain shows the presence of large numbers of spirilliform bacteria. What look like they are along in the mucosal surface, but actually some of them are intracellular. And there are immunohistochemical procedures available to diagnose this organism, but the variability of the stain sensitivity makes it impractical. And also there's often a lot of background staining associated with the immunohistochemical procedure. So it can confound the interpretation of the result. And I still think that the best way to do it is just with the Wharton starry stain. Streptococcus pneumoniae is sometimes seen in the cattle trichets and has been associated with uncooked horse meat in mixed exhibits that include cattle trichets and tree shrews. Also never a good idea to mix these animals. Strep pneumoniae causes meningitis and septicemia. Streptococcus zoepidemicus causes sepsis in the tree shrews and cattle trichets. Streptococcal lesions are primarily fibrinous, and they like the surfaces of the viscera, especially the pleural surface, where here we have a real bad fibrinous pleural component. And also we have some fibrinous change occurring back here on the gallbladder. And also in the joint, in this fixed brain, you can see some opacity here along the ventral aspect of the brainstem and cerebellum, and that corresponds to the fibrinous meningitis. Histologically, the streptococcal infections that involve lung have a very characteristic appearance of sort of a serpiginous or tortuous pattern of fibrin deposition and necrosis that courses its way through the pulmonary parenchyma. Nothing else has a lesion like this, in my opinion. And then higher magnification showing the fibrinal subject of inflammation that is present in this image, involving also a terminal bronchiole and disrupting the bronchiole wall. Note the marked edema that's present within the alveoli, also some fibrin deposition. Tissue Gram stain, in this case a good pasture stain, shows the gram-positive cocci that are present within the lesion. Klebsiella pneumoniae is a bad actor in primates. Whereas it's primarily an opportunist, it seems to have enough virulence to be a substantial disease-causing organism in the primates, especially in the cattle trichets, where it can be associated with meningitis. And of course, peritonitis and pneumonia. Basically, a septic process, but it doesn't like the meninges. This organism has a prominent capsule, so when you do a stain on it, you sometimes see that there's a clear space around the organisms that is more prominent than you'll see in some of the other bacterial infections. And subsequently, the exudate, you'll see grossly, sometimes has a sort of gelatinous appearance to it. This is the cerebrum. Numerous foci of red discoloration or streaking are present throughout the cerebral cortex. This is due to bacterial embolism in the vessel walls or subsequent necrosis of the vessel wall and perivascular hemorrhage. Meninges here are markedly thickened due to suppurative inflammation. And tissue gram stain, in this case a good pastor's gram stain shows gram negative organisms within the inflammatory cell population. Two different species of Helicobacter have been associated with disease in primates, primarily involving the pylori and antral regions of the mucosa, especially in the drills, mandrills, baboons. In humans, these organisms, I think especially pylori, have been associated with gastric lymphoma and gastric adenocarcinomas. I don't think that translates to the non-human primates, though. I'm not sure about that, but I have not seen anything in my archives related to neoplastic transformation associated with these organisms in these primates. However, the gastritis associated with the inflammation, with the infection, seems to be fairly common in some of the drills. Be honest with you, though, I've also seen the organism in the stomach of various species of primates in which there's no lesion at all. The question is, what are the factors that are associated with disease and this organism in the stomach? There must be some other predisposing factor, species predilections that cause disease. Typical appearance of gastritis due to Helicobacter, blood clots or granular brown material along the mucosal surfaces that correspond to erosions and ulcers in the mucosa, inflammation in the lamina propria of the pyloric region or antral region, a little bit higher magnification. Sometimes the inflammation extends into the tubules or is associated with tubular aggregation. And again, the Warfensari staining, you can see these organisms along the surfaces of the epithelial cells, and sometimes within the canaliculi between epithelial cells, they're rod-shaped, undulating, and sometimes spiral-shaped. We see various forms of clostridial infection in primates, not particularly common. Botulism, uncommon in zoo primates. Tetanus, probably uncommon in zoo primates, although sometimes I think we miss tetanus. Animals are found dead in the exhibit. No prior signs of illness. However, in a troop, collection of primates, once one animal appears to be sick, the more likely it's going to be killed by the other animals in the exhibit. And, an animal that develops tetanus can't move very well, and he might be killed before the keepers have even seen any kind of clinical signs of illness. And tetanus is not a disease that we're going to be able to diagnose histologically. And it might have occurred, the disease, from a bite wound, or a fence wound, a penetrating wound from a fence, a tree, a stump, anything could have induced the lesion. It could be a very small lesion that would be missed at necropsy. So I think we probably underdiagnosed tetanus in the zoos. And then we also see various forms of enteric clostridiosis, you know, Clostridium perfringens associated enterotoxemia. There is an interesting lesion that occurs in primates, including humans and including other mammals, called emphysematous gastritis, which is an accumulation of gas bubbles or air-filled lymphatics within the mucosa of the stomach. This is a typical appearance of Clostridial enteritis, acute necrosis of the mucosal wall, and lining the areas of the necrosis are large numbers of bacteria, a little bit higher magnification, some of the bacteria lining the necrotic surface, and the tissue gram stain, in this case a good pasture stain, the bacteria are identified as large gram positive bacilli. This is a pretty much a classic lesion. Clostridial enteritis. Emphysematous gastritis is a very interesting and sometimes stunning gross presentation. The interesting thing about it is that in addition to its a remarkable gross appearance, we don't really understand why it occurs. There have been proposals that it is due to gas-producing bacteria, perhaps Clostridium. Or associated with trauma and subsequent abrogation of the lymphatic system and associated aerophagia, and it was breathing in a lot of air and getting into ruptured lymphatics. It has also been associated with diabetes mellitus in humans. But we really don't know what causes it. This is the wall of the stomach, and it is expanded by all of these clear spaces that correspond to dilated lymphatic channels filled with air. We know it's air because it is pushing whatever's left in the lymphatic channels over to the sides in a manner that an air ambulance would do, say, in a fish. Fungal infections, gross lesions are often very similar for whatever species of fungus that is involved. Primarily we see yeast forms in the primates, such as blastomycosis, coccidioidomycosis, histoplasmosis, and I think now we have to include microsporidiosis in the fungal infections, because that has been reclassified using sequence identification as a fungus rather than a protozoan. Most other cases of fungal infection are due to immunosuppression, such as Newport mycosis or Candida, cryptococcosis, pneumocystis infection. Now we have identified another pathogen, Curvularia species, which very closely resembles blastomycetes. And I suspect that in the past, we have misdiagnosed Curvularia infection as blastomycosis in some of these zoo animals. The bottom line, though, is that sequencing has added new perspectives on the identity of these organisms that are causing these mycotic infections. And that may be directly improve our understanding of the epidemiology of the infections. This is a baboon that has cryptococcosis, many small nodules in its skin. These skin nodules correspond to accumulations of these yeast organisms that have very broad pale staining or non-staining cell wall, very typical of cryptococcosis. This is a brain lesion of cryptococcosis. Note the mucoid periphery here. This is due to the broad capsule that appears in these organisms. This is an additional case where cryptococcus is involved in the feet. This is histoplasmosis. And again, a similar appearance of granulomas or white nodules distributed throughout the lung. And histologically find these yeast forms that are only about 3 or 4 or 5 microns in greatest dimension that just fill the cytoplasm of the macrophages. And corresponding histologic lesions in which the macrophages and multinucleate cells oftentimes are just filled with these organisms that are accentuated in this case with a fungal stain, GMS stain. This is a case of cutaneous blastomycosis in a baboon. Marked thickening of the dermis due to these foci granulomatous inflammation that are distributed throughout the dermis and interspersed with areas of fibrosis. Histologically, a higher magnification, histiocytic cells that occasionally contain, where are they here? Hard for me to see them at this angle here tonight. Large yeast with a thin capsule. The yeast forms varying from 15 to 25 or 30 microns. And back in the old days, if you'll allow me, maybe 10 or 15 years ago, we used to use immunohistochemical procedures to further characterize the identity of the yeast. And this is a positive immunohistochemical reaction in this case for Blastomyces imidus, but to be honest with you, there is so much cross-reaction in these yeast forms that immunohistochemistry is no longer considered a very sensitive procedure for distinguishing species, especially with the advent of PCR, where we're able to get much more sensitive results regarding the identity of the organisms. And as Fabio had talked about, the laboratories now for the fungal infections actually prefer paraffin to fresh tissue. I think they don't want to work with the fresh, with the live organism. Some of these are zoonotic. This is a case of coccidioidal mycosis. I see this fairly frequently in the United States. The zoos that are in the southwest portion of the United States are in areas that are endemic for coccidioidal mycosis, and it is particularly common in the apes, especially the chimpanzees. Like the other fungal infections, much granulomatous inflammation and nodular pattern of disease in the tissues. And histologically, granulomatous inflammation associated with very large yeast forms. These get up to 50, 75 microns in greatest dimension. Very characteristic histologic appearance. This is a monkey that has pneumocystis infection. And the pattern is similar in that there are coalescing foci, white discoloration in the parenchyma, probably would have a firm texture, maybe even slightly nodular. Histologically, an interstitial pattern of inflammation, not especially granulomatous, but interstitial. And the alveoli are filled with small spherical pale-staining basophilic structures that sometimes can look like mutants rather than an organism. Though the special stain, in this case a GMS stain, the organism stained very nicely. This is a pneumocystis greenii. Probably an opportunist associated with underlying immunosuppression. Microsporidiosis is a primary pattern. Sometimes referred to as encephalin zoonosis, that refers back to the etiologic age of encephalitozoan panicula. But not all of these organisms are encephalitozoan. There are many different kinds of microsporidia. So I just use the term microsporidiosis, and then we try to determine the genus and species by PCR. This disease is most commonly seen in neonatal calotrichids. The emperor, golden lion, cotton-top tamarins, that causes encephalitis, ganglioneuritis, hepatitis, and placentitis. We can see these things, with routine histologic examination in most cases, and then we know in which direction to go regarding identification of the organism. But nowadays, we'll just go usually straight to PCR to identify the genus and species. This is a tamarin with encephalomyelitis. Relatively random foci of mixed inflammation in the brain, higher magnification of inflammation in the liver showing primarily histocytes and neutrophils. You can sort of make out these organisms in the cytoplasm of some of these cells, but really a tissue gram stain will accentuate the presence and the morphologic features of the organism. They typically are gram positive, although can be gram variable. This is a low magnification showing a cluster of gram-positive organisms, and a higher magnification showing the morphology of the organism. They typically are full void, and they will have a portion of the organism will not stain. One pole of the organism will not stain with the gram stain. That's very characteristic. It corresponds to the polar cap of the organism, which is not gram-positive. We see candidiasis frequently. This is the hyperkeratosis on the dorsal surface of the tongue, typically associated with candidiasis. We'll also see it in the gingiva, in advanced cases of periodontal disease. And even we'll see it sometimes in the mucosal ulcers of the stomach and the intestine. But candida is opportunistic. Animals, and they usually have some other form of disease process that has predisposed them to the candida infection. It's very important for anyone who is maintaining primate populations to have an understanding of the viral diseases that occur in primates. Essential for zoo veterinarians. Some of these viruses are zoonotic, some are subclinical in one species, but fatal in another species. Some of them are oncogenic viruses. And it's good to know that screening in husbandry has now eliminated many of the different forms of viral infection that historically were problematic for zoological collections and for research settings. Using serologic screening, we've been able to eliminate diseases or viruses associated with some of these primates, including simian immunodeficiency virus, SRV type 2, or rather, I'm sorry, type D, which is essentially simian 8, simian T lymphotropic virus, and the hepatitis viruses. As soon as they have any serologic evidence of that, they're out. They get caught. Husbandry has been very helpful now in eliminating many of these things. Gloves and masks, always worn, because many of the viral infections that primates get are transmitted from us, from humans. The pneumoviruses and the herpes viruses that can cause profound disease in non-human primates are transmitted by the human population, which is problematic with zoos, which are being frequented daily by visitors, yes. And also, the keepers handling the animals daily. It's important also not to mix primates. So in regards to husbandry, we've learned not to put one species in with another to avoid these catastrophic viral infections that can cause disease. And then also rodent control. Several of the serious viral infections that we see are due to exposure to rodents. And we'll talk about it. Let's start with encephalomyelitis virus, EMC. This is a serious problem in the southern United States. Do you have encephalomyelitis virus here?
In New York, in the Boston population.
Actually, I can't hear you because of the airplane.
Well, I don't want to answer for the buttons, but that is a virus that has been in and out the porcine population.
In Europe?
Yes, in Southern Europe.
Right.
Encephalitis myocarditis in pigs.
Right. The coronavirus, right?
Yes.
So this is an agent that will cause disease in pigs. In fact, it crosses species barriers and will infect and cause death in not only pigs, but in elephants and in primates. Very short course of clinical signs, if any. What we see grossly is sometimes there'll be some mucus around the nose or bloody mucus around the nose and mouth. There might be some hyperpericardium, very slight hyperpericardium, possibly some ascites or pleural transit if the animal lives long enough. Maybe some white streaks in the heart. Those could be unrelated. Foam in the trachea. Very, very subtle gross lesions. Histologically, acute myocardial necrosis, suppurative or lymphocytic inflammation. And despite the name, encephalitis is actually a very uncommon manifestation. It's primarily myocarditis, sometimes with a concurrent interstitial pneumonia component. But myocarditis is the primary lesion and the cause of death. Definitive diagnosis requires some ancillary procedures. We used to attempt to culture the virus. It is culturable. But now PCR has been very helpful as an ancillary testing procedure. High suspicion based on the histologic lesion, but there are other organisms that can cause necrotizing myocarditis. So we have to get ancillary diagnostic testing done to assure that it's encephalomyocarditis. A history of the disease at a particular facility is also helpful. So I have a couple of zoos that have had, throughout the years, recurrent episodes of encephalomyocarditis involving various species. And it's because of the rodents bringing it in. This is a baboon with encephalomyocarditis. Note the matted facial hair. This is mostly from a combination of nasal catarrhal exudate and possibly some vomition. Very mild accumulation of transudative fluid in the pericardial sac. Heart with foci of acute inflammation associated with myofiber degeneration and necrosis. And back in the old days, we used to do some transmission electron microscopy before PCR was available. And you can actually find these small coronavirus particles within the cytoplasm. Lymphocytic chorial meningitis virus is a arena virus. And as it pertains to veterinary medicine, can be seen in small pet rodents, guinea pigs, hamsters and gerbils, I think. But where it's a problem in the zoo facilities is where it causes hepatitis in the calotrichids. They contract this disease by eating infected mice. And the disease actually was introduced to the golden lion tamarin population of one of the zoos by feeding pinkies, neonatal mice. And this is where the disease was first characterized. We can also see the disease sporadically in those exhibits in which rodents can visit the exhibit and calotrichids can eat the mice. So again, rodent control is a very important thing in the husbandry of primates. Lymphocytic chorial meningitis is associated with acute onset of inappetence, depression, jaundice because of the hepatic target. There'll be hepatosplenomegaly, some hemorrhage, and pleural or pericardial effusion. Histologically, there is some random pericortical random lymphocytic neutrophilic inflammation and necrosis, formation of so-called eosinophilic bodies that are present within the sinusoids of the liver. It's also a somewhat characteristic lesion or finding, I might add. Measles is a morbillivirus, and that affects old world and new world primates. Species susceptibility seems variable. Colobus and Calotrichids especially. Again, this is a disease that is transmitted from humans to the primates. High morbidity, high mortality. We don't see measles very much anymore in the human population because of vaccination, but there are still those that are against vaccination of children. So there are still populations that are susceptible to developing measles. Measles, by the way, in my opinion, and I think the opinion of most scientists, is a potentially eradicable disease. And if everybody vaccinated, it would be like smallpox. We would not have any more measles. Just my soapbox on that subject. Having had measles when I was a child, that measles encephalitis, that's why I talk so slow. I would not wish measles upon anybody. In the primates, high morbidity and variable, but generally high mortality, I think they get put down. Respiratory disease, diarrhea, conjunctivitis, they get a rash, a measles rash, a maculopapular rash on the ventral abdomen, inner thighs. There'll be pulmonary consolidation, and of course that's associated with pneumonia. And histologically, it is an interstitial cell, interstitial type of pneumonia, but with syncytial cell formation. And also, the skin will be involved in this process, especially the follicles. The epithelial lining of the follicles will become dysplastic, necrotic, will develop syncytial cells formation as well. And intranuclear and intracytoplasmic eosinophilic inclusions will be seen in these lesions. I won't say it's a typical measles rash because there are other diseases that have a similar appearance, such as herpes simplex or chickenpox, varicella. This is the rash that occurs with measles. The lungs will be reddened and consolidated. And then histologically, the syncytial cell formation is very impressive. And within the syncytial cells, intranuclear and occasionally intracytoplasmic inclusions characteristic of measles. Now, this can be histologically misconstrued as a herpes virus infection, so it's helpful to see the intracytoplasmic inclusions, which don't occur with the herpes virus infections. They're strictly intranuclear. Pneumoviruses are various forms and shapes in primates and a considerable concern. The metapneumovirus is a disease that can infect apes and cause pneumonia. This is especially a problem in the wild apes, chimpanzees and gorillas, and populations of mountain gorillas that are critically endangered species have been exposed and infected by metapneumovirus. So the take-home message is to always handle these animals with masks and gloves to prevent human-to-animal transmission of the virus. And it's the same with the orthopneumoviruses, or respiratory syncytial virus infections that can occur primarily in children, but these children that visit the zoos are potential vectors for these diseases in non-human primates. And we just published one paper on the occurrence of human respiratory syncytial virus in a gibbon, which is the smallest of the apes. And no doubt that was transmitted by a visitor to the zoo. Influenza virus, a major problem in the zoological population. Of course, this is all transmitted also from humans visiting the zoos that have influenza. Anytime the keepers have influenza, they don't go to work. They just stay home. But people coming into the zoo, there's no way to tell if they got influenza. So subsequently, influenza will go through the whole troop of animals. Everybody's coughing and sneezing and so forth. It's uncommon to have fatalities due to influenza, but in the older animals, they can die as a result of influenza. It's a particularly virulent strain of influenza in a relatively old animal or an animal that has other disease processes. And we do have some great apes that have died due to influenza, but they were older animals. Case of influenza in gorilla, consolidated lungs, much edema. One of the characteristic features of the pneumovirus infections is not so much syncytial cell formation, but the formation of hyaline membranes along the surfaces of the interstitium of the lung. And this is an immediate tip-off to the histopathologist that they may have a viral infection. We don't always see real nice syncytial cell formation arising from the epithelial cells of the terminal airways, and only rarely do we see them arising from the alveolar cells. Immunohistochemistry can be used to identify viral antigen. We are generally using human reagents for this procedure. State this, but the dynamics of various herpes virus infections in the primates is just a classic example of why we should not mix primates in the exhibits. For instance, herpes hominis, or the herpes simplex virus, the one that infects us, causes cold sores. Very common. Human to monkey, monkey to human transmission of this lesion. But in some species, such as the gibbon, the chimp, some of these other listed species, they can be associated with severe disease. And in calotrichids, it can be fatal. Vesicles, plaques, erosions on the mucous membranes, ulceration of the skin, systemic necrosis and inflammation associated with this disease in the calotrichids. Severe ulceration of the skin around the mouth, on the ventrum, in the tongue, and then can't see it very well here, but extensive foci necrosis throughout the hepatic parenchyma associated with the organism that causes cold sores. So, we want to avoid mixing primates, including humans, with these other species of primates, unless you're taking precautions. This is the brain of a calotrichid with herpes simplex infection. There's inflammation and necrosis occurring within the neuron pile, and many of the neuron cell bodies, the ganglionic cells, glial cells, have large intranuclear inclusions typical of herpes virus inclusions. Varicella represents a group of closely related herpes viruses that resemble human varicella or chickenpox. And latency is common in primates, so that they can be carriers or transmitted to others. But acute fatal disease can also occur primarily in the whole world monkeys, and gross lesions, very similar to measles, cutaneous oral vesicles, necrosis, and syncytia with intranuclear inclusions in the viscera. Chickenpox rash occurring in this primate. Again, areas of necrosis, these little white foci throughout the parenchyma, and the histologic appearance, very typical of herpes virus, large and particular inclusions occurring within epithelial cells. Papillomavirus associated lesions are somewhat common as well, especially in the rhesus, cows, colmus, and then the drills and baboon group, and possibly in the pararectal region of the lemurs. Not sure about them. They have a similar lesion. The papillomas occur in the oral and mucocutaneous regions and in the skin. They have a typical papilloma appearance, rough, raised papillomatous or hyperkeratotic surface. And they can be singular or multiple. And histologically, they have a typical appearance. Papillomatous formation of well differentiated with hyperplastic epithelium with some hyperkeratosis, and sometimes with coelocyte formation or infection or intranuclear inclusions. Generally, these tumors spontaneously regress, with some exceptions, particularly the rhesus. Rhesus papillomavirus 1 is a model for human papillomas associated cervical cancer. Because in the rhesus, this papillomavirus causes dysplastic changes and subsequent transformation to squamous cell carcinoma, a tumor that can metastasize and is transmitted sexually, very similar to papillomavirus infection in humans. Large foci, papilloma formation in the perigoldwater region and the mucocutaneous junction, also papilloma formation along the penis, and after transformation, metastatic lesions in the lung, squamous cell carcinoma, rhesus. We'll conclude with a few of the parasitic diseases. Can't cover all of them, there's so many, but some of the important ones. We'll start with hematicosis, which is primarily a disease of the calotrichids. Can be quite striking. Some hair loss and swelling of the dermis around the facial region in this animal, corresponding to large numbers of the organisms present within the follicles. This will result folliculitis and then subsequently furunculosis, and when that follicle ruptures, boy, it invokes a really severe autoimmune inflammatory response, and that accounts for the nodularity of the skin. Pulmonary acrophysis, this is a disease that is primarily old world monkeys, but especially prominent in the macaques and in the drills, the mandrills, baboons, that group of monkeys. They're transmitted by direct contact, aerosol exposure, oral nasal, mother to offspring type of transmission. And infected lung will form these large bulbi that are associated with the organism in the lung and, of course, the brown pigment that represents the expiratory material of the mice, and sometimes also the eggs. Clinical presentation of pulmonary acarthritis in a baboon. Note multiple foci, pale discoloration and cyst formation corresponding to the bull egg. This is a transverse section through one of the bull egg showing the clear lumen that was essentially the cystic portion of the lesion. And then histologically, here's one of the mites within one of these bull egg. And surrounding the mite are areas of inflammation directed primarily at this brown pigment material, which is the expiratory material of the mite. Sometimes mite eggs will also be in this. And this is what these awful little creatures look like when they're outside of the lungs. Amebiasis is still occasionally seen in primates. Amoeba histolytica, which is an organism that can also cause enteric amebiasis in humans, causes pseudomembranous enterocolitis. And once it gets through the mucosa of the intestine, it then embolizes to the liver and causes severe hepatic necrosis and associated mixed inflammation in the liver as well. This is a section of the colon that has enteric amebiasis. These are areas of ulceration, pseudomembrane formation. Once it embolizes to the liver, it forms these areas of necrosis and associated inflammation. Interestingly enough, in the leaf-eating monkeys like the colobus, we see similar lesion in the stomach. The stomach serving similar function in leaf eaters as the cecum does in the other monkeys. Usually, these animals will also have bacterial septicemia because of the application of the mucosa of the intestine associated with this organism. So they sort of have a dual infection of opportunistic enteric bacteria and the amoeba. Here's a site of amebiasis occurring in the colon, inflammation associated with ulceration of the mucosa, the lesion extending into the submucosa, where it's associated now with some edema. And what will happen is the organism will invade this region, get into the blood vessels, and then it will embolize to other tissues like the liver. Here it is in the liver. These are the organisms present within the liver and the associated inflammatory response. A little bit higher magnification showing the organism within foci of inflammation. And this is an immunofluorescence stain performed at the Centers for Disease Control. This is what we used to use to distinguish which organism it was, whether it was an amoeba or an amoeba or Balanuthia. There are a number of different amoebic organisms that can cause disease in primates. And at one time, there was an investigator that was particularly interested in the amoeba, so I used to send him all my amoeba stuff. And he has since retired, and we don't do that anymore. So we're looking for another source to identify the organisms using PCR, which is probably the next area that will be developed for identification of these amoeba. There is a cephalic form of amebiasis that occurs in primates, particularly gorillas. I've also found it in metallic trichids, but a different organism but the same lesion. In the gorillas, the disease is associated with Balanuthia. In the calotrichids, the disease is associated with acanthamoeba. But regardless of the name of the organism, the pathogenesis is the same. These animals are exposed to the organism in contaminated water, and it gets into the system and goes straight to the brain, and also will involve the eyes. And of course, once you get an amoeba in the brain or in the eyes, it's going to evoke a lot of necrosis and inflammation. And it's the body's reaction to these organisms that causes the clinical signs. And usually these animals are put down or die due to the severity of a lesion. This is the brain showing inflammation and hemorrhage associated with the organism. Higher magnification showing the amoeba within the lesion. This is a gorilla. This is a calotrichid that has a amoebic encephalitis as well. And these are the organisms present within the brain. The acanthamoeba are smaller than the Balanuthia, so I have them here for comparison in the same magnification. Acanthamoeba organism, Balanuthia organism. Larger organism than the acanthamoeba with the same pathogenesis. And this is the acanthamoeba using the immunofluorescence technique. We still see toxoplasmosis. I suspect that toxoplasmosis is also endemic in Europe. The squirrel monkeys and calotrichids are especially sensitive to developing toxoplasmosis. I think that the life cycle involves feral cats that visit the zoos and are contaminating the substrate, and then cockroaches or mice or a handful bringing that into the exhibits, so that the primates are getting exposed to it. And the affected animals will develop clinical signs that reflect the organ involvement that is most severe. And usually that's going to be the liver or the heart. And what we see is necrotizing enteritis, lymphadenitis. Because it is usually an oral route of infection, we'll also see enteritis and myocarditis, pneumonia, encephalitis, etc. If a female is pregnant, then we will see placentitis, neonatal death, prenatal death, and abortion. This is a heart showing the extensive inflammation. Again, you know, we see these cases of myocarditis, the mixed inflammatory process. There are many differentials for that lesion, including several myocarditis, virus, anisomiasis, streptococcal infection, many things that can cause that. So if we're lucky, though, we will find some protozoan cysts in the cytoplasm of some of the myofibers. This helps us to establish that the lesion is at least protozoal. And we can go from there as to which protozoans may be using PCR. But anyway, histologically, they become very familiar with the histological appearance of toxoplasmosis, and we don't need to do much else. But in this particular case, myocarditis, encephalitis, note that the protozoan cyst is somewhat removed from the inflammatory process in this case, and that's sort of typical of toxoplasma as well. It's not actually, the inflammation is not actually directed at the cyst, but after the cyst ruptures, then the sporozoites, the merozoites, migrate into the tissues and invoke the inflammatory response. Cytologic appearance of the merozoites in a macrophage, in the Buffy coats here. Actually, sometimes if lucky, in a Buffy coat. Valentinian coli is a prevalent organism in the zoo primates and can cause, generally will cause a mild degree chronic colitis in the apes. Only rarely does it cause severe colitis, but we do occasionally see severe colitis, type of colitis associated with this organism invading into the lamina propria or filling up the crypts. This is the colonic mucosa. These are the glands and crypts, and this is the interstitium. The interstitium has a mild or moderate inflammatory response to these organisms present within the lumen. These are the organisms here. They're in the lumen of the glands and also in the lumen of the crypts. Generally, we only see them out on the surface, but to see them in the glands and crypts here is a more advanced manifestation, a more severe manifestation of Valentinian infection in the apes, and will cause substantial diarrhea can be problematic and treated. Echinococcosis is only rarely seen down in the zoos. It implies that these animals have been exposed to feces of an infected carnivore. And of course, once this organism gets in, migrates into the abdominal cavity and forms these hydatid cysts. It is cosmopolitan, and there are two organisms, Echinococcus multilocularis in the northern hemisphere and granulosis in the southern hemisphere. Can be quite profound with formation of large numbers of hydatid cysts throughout the abdominal cavity, sometimes also involving the parenchyma of tissues, especially the liver. And this is a zoonotic disease that implies, that the environment in which this animal was housed has some potential for transmission of the zoonotic agent. We have a very nice exhibit right over here. The conococcosis. It's in a pig. It's in the liver. It looks pretty old too. 1941, I think it's gone. I'm not sure what the date is on it, but it's a very nice example of the conococcus in the liver. Strongyloides infections can be problematic primarily in great age. They have a direct life cycle, so if the husbandry is not good, if the birth has a heavy burden of the eggs, then super infections can occur in the great apes and cause overwhelming enteritis and subsequent. What these animals do is they get real bad inflammation and erosions associated with the nematode, and then secondary bacterial infections kill them. So this is a disease that is treatable and a good reason for doing routine fecal exams from the exhibit floor. We also see chronic lipworm infections in primates, several different species of primates. Colobus seems particularly prone to it. But the cecal and proximal colon in the colobus in the stomach, mild inflammation and proliferation of the mucosa. And the whips, the head of the worm is embedded in the mucosa, and then the tail end of it is flapping around in the lumen of the intestine. I think we can see it here. There you can see these whipworms here along the mucosal surface. This is a prolapsed colon associated with these relatively heavy whipworm burden. You can see the organisms coming off the surface of the colon. Sometimes we see intussusceptions of the ileocecal colic junction associated with whipworms. Gonzoonema lives in the mucosa of the upper alimentary tract. Oftentimes we'll see them in the tongue, in the esophagus. They generally are incidental, although occasionally in the tongue can be associated with concurrent with Pasteurella septicemia. It has a cockroach intermediate host, so another reason for good vermin control, and it can affect old world and new world monkeys. Capillariasis is a disease where we see problems not only with the adults in the mucosa of the intestine or mucosa of the ducts, but also the granulomas associated with the eggs that are deposited in these in the tissues, particularly in the liver of the lemur. Here we have numerous foci of granulomatous inflammation oriented around clusters of capillary eggs in the liver. And this is not something that is just confined to the lemur. We see capillariasis as a major problem in some of the other captive rodent species, in ruminants, and in birds. A lot of problems with capillariasis in the birds. It's a difficult worm to deal with because it lives in the mucosa. It only sheds eggs intermittently. It can be difficult for the clinicians to diagnose it, subsequently difficult to diagnose. And it's capable of causing substantial lesion development, wasting, and can be a major problem. Just a few miscellaneous diseases before we break for lunch. About bloat just for a minute. Found dead. That's the history on this one. Big bloated app. Why they do this, nobody knows. Has been proposed that it occurs following following eating a meal, or associated with activity or anesthesia, volvulus or underlying disease processes. But the trouble with all of those is none of them are consistent. I mean, sometimes we'll have a bloat case that doesn't have any food in the stomach. And so we can't say that they're all caused because they just went out and ate and then played around with somebody and developed bloat. or that they have a load associated with bacterial overgrowth due to stasis. That's a very difficult disease to understand, in my opinion, but common. And in fact, has been a substantial cause of death in one of the chimpanzee sanctuaries in Sierra Leone. Gastric dilatation bulbus, perhaps a little bit easier to understand, because these animals do often have a history of having just eaten and having increased activity, rolling around with another animal, or being stressed out. And of course, with the bulbus, usually there'll be some splenic entrapment as well. And these can be anything from, you know, 180 degrees to several different twists of the stomach. And also a situation that found dead, you know, very acute presentation. And endometriosis, a disease best characterized perhaps in women, but also fairly common in certain species of primates, particularly baboons and mandrills. We occasionally will see it in other old world primates. It is not a disease of new world primates. And endometriosis occurs, you know, as endometrial glands and stroma explanted to abnormal locations outside of the uterus, mostly in the abdominal cavity, but rare cases also have been described in the thoracic cavity and in the skin. So the pathogenesis is not well understood. Typically, there'll be a nodular lesion with a lot of hemorrhage present on the serosal surface of the mesentery or one of the abdominal organs. You need histologic exam to confirm the diagnosis. And you have to have that combination of endometrial stroma and glands to distinguish it from a neoplastic process such as an adenocarcinoma, which won't have the endometrial stroma. The mandrill is actually so susceptible to developing this disease that it is considered a model for the study of endometriosis in men. And that is it for our primate lectures for today. Any questions about primates? No primate questions?
I will have a comment. Do you think the bloat that you saw could be associated with some sugar treats that they get, like you know, jelly beans? Because the non-sugar version of jelly beans could be associated with transient bloats in humans. Not the one with calories, the one without calories, which have a lot of cyanide. So I was wondering if that may get something.
Well, I think it's possible. I wouldn't be the only one, of course, because it occurs in those populations that haven't been treated. I mean, fed treats, okay. I should say. And feeding treats like that, generally frowned upon now in zoos. Some zoos still do that, and even some zoos have the public has access to the animals and feeding the animals. So that could be a problem for some. But it is not consistently a problem. Like I say, some of these have empty stomachs. That it? Okay.